We will show the two properties individually, starting with closeness. So what do we have to show? We have seen that closed subsets can be characterized by taking a convergence sequence inside the set. The limit must lie in the set again. So there we can use the sequential compactness, and it's a bit tedious to work this out, but the details are actually quite simple. So let's Xn be a sequence in A, which converges to some element A, for which we only know that it's in X. So we need to show it lies in A. Now, since A is compact, by theorem, so the theorem we just had, 1167, I think, yes, the 1167, there exists a subsequence, xnk, which converges in, a little mistake here, sorry about that. Now I'm going to use a statement which I technically haven't introduced, but the proof is very simple because it's basically transferring the one-dimensional proof again to metric spaces as we did with other results about sequences. Namely, subsequences of convergent sequences converge to the same limit. A is the name of the set, sorry. Converge to the same limit. It follows that this limit here, A, must also be the limit of the subsequence xnk, but as we said, this converges in A, so this lies in A. So we've proven the claim because this is now, we've taken an arbitrary sequence in A which converges in the big space X, and we've shown that the limit must lie in A. So this shows, and this was the characterization of compact of closed subsets from theorem 1153. This implies A is closed. Okay, so much for the closedness. Now for the boundedness. Basically, we're using the same argument I used to show that norm vector spaces are not bounded, to show that it's bounded. Namely, we fix an element, let x0 be some fixed element in A. Consider all balls of arbitrary radius around x0, where r so is some positive number. This is an open cover of A. Technically, if we take the union of all these, we get everything. We get X, so especially it's an open cover of A. So since A is compact, we have a finite subcover. So there are R1 to Rm in 0 to plus infinity, such that A is in the union of these finitely many balls. Bri around x0, but this is again the same as the ball of radius r of x0, where r is just the biggest of the radii, the maximum of r1 to Rm. Okay, but we've seen, so A is contained in one big ball, so A is bounded. Okay, so compact sets are closed and bounded, and our next big aim is now to see that in Rn, if we take compact subsets of Rn, this is equivalent. So then really closed and bounded sets are compact in the sense we introduced before. But to do this, we need a little more preparations. We need to show this, but there we will see that in Rn, we just need to check if a set is closed and bounded, which is, of course, much, much, much easier than studying open covers or whatever. So this is kind of the main criterion to show that, to characterize compact sets. Just one little observation, which is now immediate from the previous statement, about compact subsets of R. So, and this time, compact in our new sense, so in this open cover sense, not in the closed and bounded sense. So assume that K is a subset of R, which is compact in the sense of definition, what was it then, 1164, so in this open cover sense, not in the math one sense, then it follows that K contains its supremum and it contains its infimum. So both of them are elements of K. So, and this is now an easy consequence of the previous theorem, namely, by theorem 1170, K is bounded. So this means supremum and infimum are real numbers, so it makes sense what we're talking about. So sup K and inf K are both in R. Okay, good. And so by closeness of K, which also follows from that theorem, it then follows that we can, of course, then if the supremum and infimum are finite, we can approximate them by sequences in K. So we can really write the supremum of a set or the infimum of a set, if they are numbers, really as the limit of a sequence in that set. And thus, by closeness, it has to be in there. So by closeness of K, it directly follows that sup K and inf K must be in K. Okay, so this is just some observation. So sup and inf, please keep in mind, this only makes sense for real numbers. So in this setting, this is a particular consequence, what we already know about compact sets at this point. Okay, now to get the characterization in Rn, or Rk as I would probably call it. So to show that closed and bounded sets are compact, we need a bit more preparations. And guess who's back? We have to study an old friend of ours and study it in Rk. Namely, one of our beloved theorems about sequences in R, and a particularly useful statement, which is probably a bit confusing for any Math 1 student, the beautiful Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem. Theorem, but this time in Rk. So, this time, so we now know what bounded sequences are. So in Bolzano-Weierstrass, for real numbers, said that every real sequence of real numbers which is bounded has a convergent subsequence. We have now learned in the previous section what bounded sequences are, so we have this notion here as well, and it turns out the precisely same statement holds. So if K in N is arbitrary, then every bounded sequence in Rk in Rk has a convergent subsequence. Oh, I think I'm getting a visitor again. Sorry about that, another visitor, but anyway. So let's prove this theorem. Now, we will do this by induction over K. Okay, the base case. If k is equal to 1, then we already know this, because for k equals 1, this is precisely the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem from Math 1. So this is theorem 248. Okay, so this is what we already know. Okay. Now for the induction step. First of all, what do we assume? Assume as induction hypothesis that every bounded sequence in RK has a convergent subsequence. Okay, now we do the same, we have to show that the same holds in RK plus 1. So we take a sequence in RK plus 1 and we need to go via the components. So we have x1n, x2n, and so on for the component sequences. 2xkn, 2xk plus 1n. This is now a sequence indexed by n, be bounded in RK plus 1. And let them be bounded by some constants, so that R be a positive number such that the Euclidean norm of each element, x1n and so on, to xkn, xk plus 1n, is smaller than R, or equal to R for all n in n. Then, by definition of the Euclidean norms, and this is now a step that I will cut short because this is something we've already seen, then if we just take the Euclidean norm in RK and remove the final component, so we just take x1n to xkn, then the Euclidean norm of this must also be bounded from below by R, simply by definition of the Euclidean norms. The difference between these and these is that here one more non-negative summand is below the square root, so this just increases. We've seen this a lot of times already. This holds for all n and n. So this is a bounded sequence in RK, and so by induction hypothesis, there exists a convergent subsequence x1nk, x2nk, k is already taken, let's call this xn, 1nl, so l is now our new index, x to xknl, l in n. Okay, now we could just add the final component and take the subsequence there as well, but we don't know if that one converges. So let's study this one separately. So xk plus 1n is also bounded by the same argument here. Namely, we also know that if this Euclidean norm here is smaller than or equal to R, then the absolute value of these components must especially be smaller than or equal to R, meaning all the component sequences are bounded as well. So this is also bounded in R. And of course, now we cannot take an arbitrary subsequence of this because we are stuck kind of to make it. If we would take a convergent subsequence of this one, we might have entirely different indices than taken here. So the trick is now to say this is bounded. So if we restrict from the beginning to the subsequence, to the indices of the subsequence, but to this last component, we take xk plus 1 nl. This is bounded. So this is a bounded sequence in R, and now we take a subsequence of this sequence. So here, by the one-dimensional Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem 240, what was it, 8, there exists a convergent subsequence X, and now we have to, this now gets really ugly. K plus 1, n, l, and a subsequence of this, another index m, another triple index. Hey, having fun here. Indexed by m and n. And now, if we take this subsequence and also pass to that subsequence of this convergent sequence, the result will converge. So This, if we now take the subsequence x1 nlm to x k nlm and go to xk plus 1 nlm indexed by m. Now we've seen that these converge individually and that this sequence converges, but we've seen already convergence in rk or k plus 1 is the same as the convergence of the component sequences. So since this guy here converges in rk, all of the first k component sequence converge in r. This component sequence converges in R. This is the way we constructed it. And so by applying this theorem there, we get that the whole thing converges in RK plus 1. And this theorem was 11.7. This converges in RK plus 1. So we started with a bounded sequence in RK plus 1 and found a convergent subsequence. So this completes the induction step and thereby proves Bolzano-Weierstrass for arbitrary dimensions. Okay, this is also a nice thing to have. And with this in mind and with what we already know about compact sets, we can now characterize compact subsets in RK. Let me erase. The theorem about compact subsets in RK has a name. It is the so-called Heine-Borel theorem. In our numbering, it's 1173. Heine-Borel, named after a German mathematician called Heine, I don't know his first name, and Armand Borel, I think. Yeah, French mathematician. So, yeah, German-French cooperation. So, let n in n, and let k in Rn, then K is compact. Sorry, let me change to K here, otherwise I'll have a sequence in this proof. So where I, anyway, so K subset in RK. K is compact if and only if K is closed and bounded. And this is a good characterization. This is easy to check. Proof. So the one direction we already know, so this implication holds generally for metric spaces. So this follows from theorem 1170, which said precisely that. So the interesting part is the other inclusion. Not inclusion, implication. So assume we have a subset which is closed and bounded. Now let we will now use this characterization of compactness by sequences. So it suffices to show that every sequence in K has a convergent subsequence which converges in K. And we just basically have to put together what we have seen in the previous statements, namely that Xn be an arbitrary sequence in K. So we assume in this implication that K is bounded, which implies, and this is easy to check, that the sequence itself is bounded. And this implies now by Bolzano-Weierstrass that we have a convergent subsequence. So Bolzano-Weierstrass. There exists a subsequence xnk, k is already taken, sorry, xnl, l in n, converging, and so far we only know that it converges in rk, but we know that k is closed. This is the other assumption, and we have seen for closed sets, if we have a sequence converging in the big set, big space, which lies completely in this set K, we know that the limit then lies in K again. So this is by theorem, what was 1153. So it follows that the limit of X, XNL is again in K. So XN n in n has a subsequence converging in K. And since it was an arbitrary sequence, we now use the sequential compactness characterization. This is theorem 11, was it 67? This shows K is compact. So, closed and bounded subsets of RK are compact. And this now means that we can write down some more examples of compact subsets. I mean, some of the sets we've already seen so far. So, example 1174. Okay, every closed ball. So, first example, every closed ball. So B bar R around x0 in RK is compact. They are bounded by definition and they are closed as we've seen. So closed, this was theorem, which was that? I haven't written this down yet. Sorry, it's closed and bounded. Hence, compact. And here, of course, I mean x0 is some point in Rk, k and m, and r is bigger than 0. Okay, so every closed ball is compact. And also, now we can characterize compact intervals. So an interval I subset of r is compact. So in the sense of the previous definition, so definition 11 point, what was the number? Oops, 64. So compact in this new sense, if and only if, so if, only if, so it is closed and bounded, and closed and bounded intervals in this setting are just the intervals we called compact intervals before. So intervals of this form AB, where AB are in R. So this is kind of basically, it only shows that our old notion of compactness by just being closed and bounded coincides with the new one. So we've really extended the old stuff, so there's no contradiction to anything from mathematics one. So more generally, if we take numbers a1 to ak and b1 to bk in R, then the product of these, so q, what is q? In German it's called a quader. I actually don't know the precise English word. I think some use the word hyperrectangle, so multi-dimensional rectangle. Please, any native speakers watching, please let me know what's the correct name for these. a1, b1. Times a2, b2, and so on, to ak, bk. These are bounded because we can always find a big ball such that this fits in this big ball if the radius is big enough. I won't prove this here. And we've already seen, just in the case of a rectangle, but the general case works in the same way, that this is closed. So this is a subset of Rk, is compact. Okay, now, I've told you before that in general metric spaces, Heine-Borel is not correct. So a subset is not compact if and only if it is closed and bounded. And I will give you a counterexample now. So, remark 1175. So the assertion of Heine-Borel is false. It's false for arbitrary metric spaces. And we shall see an example that we've already studied in detail. Namely, we consider again the space of bounded functions, namely B from R to R. So, bounded functions from R to R with the supernorm. And of course, with a metric induced by the supernorm. Now that we study the zero function, we let so that zero in B R R be the zero function. And consider the following set. We just take A to be the closed ball of radius 1 around 0. Okay, what is this? Just explicitly, this is the set of all F in BRR such that the supernorm of F is smaller than or equal to 1. And this, of course, is the same as the set of all F in BRR such that the sup over all x in R of the absolute value of f of x is smaller than or equal to 1. Okay, this is just the definition of the set. Now, it's a closed ball, so it's closed. So A is closed. We have seen all closed balls are closed. And it's bounded. This is trivial. I mean, the closed ball obviously fits into a ball. So this is closed and bounded. But not compact. Okay, so here's something infinite dimensional, so to say. So there it always goes wrong with compactness. So why is that? So by our description in terms of sequences, it suffices just to write down any arbitrary sequence in A which does not have a convergent subsequence. And we shall do just that. So consider the sequence Fn, subset of A, and Fn is defined in a very simple way. So please note, we just have bounded function, there's no need for continuity, so we can basically do almost anything. And we just take the very simple function Fn of x, which is 1 if x is n, and 0 if x is not n. Okay, very, very boring. But it turns out, so the supernorm of Fn, this is always 1. This is clear because, yeah, what's the supremum of the absolute values? We always have this point where it's 1 and 0 everywhere else. So this is 1 for all n in n. Moreover, if we take two different elements, Fn, and take the difference of Fn and Fm. So, of course, if n and m are the same, we just have the zero function, so then we have zero. But if n and m are not the same, we just have one point where the function is 1 and a point where the function is minus 1 and the rest where it's 0. But this means the supernorm is again 1 for all m, n, and n with m not equal to n. But what does this mean? This has an interesting consequence because these differences here are precisely the ones we investigate when we consider something, when we want to find a Cauchy sequence. But since this difference here is big and does not become smaller, 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 this means that, first of all, Fn itself cannot be a Cauchy sequence, but also every subsequence. This holds for all indices which are not the same, so no subsequence of Fn can be a Cauchy sequence. But we've seen every convergent sequence is a Cauchy sequence, so if no subsequence is Cauchy, this means no subsequence converges. So Fn does not have a convergent subsequence. And by theorem 1167, this means Fn is, sorry, not Fn, A is not compact. Okay, so this might indeed happen. So the crucial thing is here we have basically a finite dimensional norm vector space, and you could more generally show that Heine-Borel holds for all finite dimensional vector spaces, but in infinite dimensional ones, as we have here, this might go wrong, or it will in general go wrong. Okay, let me quickly erase, and then we discuss some more properties about compact subsets with regards to continuous maps. We conclude this section with some very important results about connections between compactness and continuous maps, or some properties of continuous maps when they are defined on compact sets. Namely, assume we have two metric spaces. I'll drop the metrics from the notation here because I don't need them in the proof there. We have two metric spaces. And assume we have a compact subset of X. Now, if F from X to Y is continuous, then the image of the compact set, F of K, is again compact. Images of compact sets are compact. That's a crucial result here, and this is images of compact sets under continuous maps are compact. Very, very important statement, and the proof is actually not that complicated. We again argue with open covers. So take an arbitrary open cover VI open cover of F of K. So this we need to show that there is a finite subcover of this. And we will now use the continuity because we have seen with the minimap is continuous, images of open sets are always open. So this means, and this was theorem 1151, that if I take the pre-images f to the minus 1 of vi, these here are all open again. And since this here covers f of k, this here will cover the pre-image. So is an open cover of, so the pre-image would be f to the minus 1 of f of k. But we've already we've seen in the very beginning of this course that in the previous semester's course that k is always included in this complicated guy here. So k is a subset of this. So hence of k. So this here is an open cover of k, but as k is compact, this means there exists a finite subcover. So there exists a J subset of I, which is finite, such that f to the minus 1 of Vj, let me write this explicitly. So such that K is contained in the union J in J F to the minus 1 of Vj. But if we now apply F to both sides, we know that if something is a subset of something else, then the image will be a subset of the image of this something else. This is just elementary that these inclusions are preserved. So it follows that F of K is a subset of F of the union over J in J F to the minus 1 of Vj. And here, again, you need some set theory and some properties of these of maps and unions. But here you can see the image of a union is the same as the union of the images. This is also elementary. So this is the union of J in J F of F to the minus 1 Vj. And here we know that if we are composing this way around, here we only know that K is a subset of this. But if we have a composition this way around, this is also what we saw in chapter 1 of Math 1. It's a bit complicated to get all the details right here, I admit. But this is simply Vj. So if we first pull it up and push it down again, we'll end up at the same set Vj. So this is the union over all J in J Vj. So we found a finite subcover. So F of K is a subset of this. So there exists a finite subcover of F of K. So since we start with an arbitrary open cover, it follows that F of K is compact. OK. This was very short and not too complicated, just the details about the set theory and so on. But anyway, and this has now this beautiful consequence that we will also make use of later a great deal. Namely, if we have the special case, so if xd So basically, I can again drop the metric. If X is a compact metric space, so X, this means, I haven't defined this explicitly, but this means X is kind of compact in itself, so just some compact metric space. And F is a continuous map from X to the real numbers, so just some real-valued function. If this is continuous, then it follows that F attains its minimum and its maximum. And its maximum, in other words, there are points x small m and x capital M in our domain x, such that f of x capital M is the supremum over all f of x, where x in x, and f of x small m is the infimum over all x in x f of x. This is then also called the maximum. We can also write this by max and min, but I hope it's clear what I mean. And so this is just applying previous theorem. So by theorem 1176, the image f of x is compact in R. So we've seen that by this, what I formulated as corollary 1171, this means that sup f of x, which is just another way of writing this here, and inf of f of x have to lie in this set. And this is by definition just this here. If they are in the image here, this means there is some point in x at which f of x takes these values, and this is what we wanted. So this already shows the claim. So continuous functions on compact metric spaces or compact subsets of metric spaces with the restriction of the metric, of course, always attain minimum and maximum. Okay. Now I will conclude with another theorem, which is really a straightaway generalization of a result from Mathematics 1. Because there we've also discussed the relation between compactness and uniform continuity. Mainly, we have shown the following. If X and Y, so here the generalization to metric spaces. If X and Y are metric spaces, and F from X to Y is continuous. Now, if X is compact, so the domain, then F is uniformly continuous. Okay, this continuous functions on compact subsets are always uniformly continuous. The uniform continuity we have generalized in the previous section here in the setting of metric spaces. And this theorem, already if you just consider the case of compact subsets of C, so of the complex numbers, then we had this in Mathematics 1. And the proof is also basically transferring this and using the notions of compactness there in a smart way. And I will not do the proof. The good news is I won't discuss the proof here. The bad news is you will do the proof. This will be exercise 4 on sheet 11. So there's work for you to do. Okay, this completes the chapter on metric spaces, and I hope if you kind of have problems dealing with abstractions that you still can follow roughly the main ideas here. So from the next chapter on, we will then deal with now really concretely differentiability of functions on Rn and really generalize the constructions of derivatives, differentials, and so on in a beautiful way, and really in it's kind of one of the most beautiful parts of this math, of the whole math course here, I think. I personally like these topics a lot, and so we will see how differentiability generalizes and how we have a notion of differentiability, and we will make use of linear algebra, we will make use of several other things from the previous semester and so on, but we will really find a good framework to get a calculus for functions from Rn to Rm in general. Okay, so much for abstract metric spaces, then see you in the next chapter.